So yeah, so this mama horse is has been very, very good with her baby. Has not shown any kind of negativity towards it. Is fine with all the feeding. And even better, she's not so protective that it's like dangerous or anything to approach it. When we got there, they were already going into the stall with her, like the humans were already going into the stall with mom and baby and just kind of hanging out right next to them. And the foal was already coming up to get pets too, which is also a really good sign, especially for a horse that you're intending to bring into captivity. If it's not immediately scared of people, that's a good thing because that's less sensitivity training you have to do. So yeah, baby was more than happy with being pet, all about the snuggles. So it was a really nice sign to see. And yeah, same thing with yesterday and today. We got to see a little bit more of it because the barn was pretty quiet the last 2 days. People had all kinds of events going on. So, yeah. I also learned that baby horses, the color of their coat is not determined right away. So what they look like now is not what did you say, a few months?
It takes a while. I don't remember exactly how long it is. But yeah, it's at least a few.
Yeah. So it takes a few months for their true coat to come out, which is why it's really interesting. It's not even a matter of like a genetic test before they're born. It's actually, if you're trying to imagine what kind of horse you're going to get, you won't know until several months after it's been born. Up until that point, it's actually kind of a guessing game. So, anyways, right now she's a really dark brown, same color as her mama. I'll take some more pictures. I think I sent you guys a picture in chat. If not, I'll get another one next time we're there, and send you guys another one. But yeah, right now she's a really dark brown, but kind of a question mark where she'll end up. Kind of exciting. They haven't named it yet. They're calling it Buttercup, but it's hilarious because one of the ladies who owns the barn is like, the last time they had a baby horse, they changed the name 5 times. Within a month. So the teenager, they're teenagers now. I guess last time they had a baby horse they were like 10, so maybe they've matured a little bit, but probably not. They're still, you know, teenage horse girls. I'm sure the name will change a little bit, but yeah, right now its name is Buttercup. Its mom's name is Sushi, so you don't know what to expect when it comes to girls who name their own horses, which is kind of funny to me. This motherfucker. Anyway, this part of the game is interesting because you have the humans who are all over the place, but you also have the, I call them Nazis, but technically they're the Spaniards. I guess there could be some Nazis mixed in there too if they got El Dorado open. But yeah, you have the naked monsters running around the whole time too, causing havoc. They will go after you, but they will also, more importantly, go after the soldiers. And in that case, it's best just to stand back and let them do their thing, because they are going to save you some bullets. I already announced this, but I don't think Shu is here. So yeah, when I start Uncharted 2, I'm just going to do it on Crushing instead of Brutal, because a lot of the walkthroughs I was reading online said that the first one was the hardest of the three on Brutal. I'm definitely finding the second one to be harder than the first one. And I think it's because the same techniques that you use in the first one don't work, and also the number of enemies per encounter is just insane. There's some fights where you have a wave of literally 40 or 50 people with no checkpoint, so that's kind of a bitch. So yeah, to save everyone a little bit of sanity, when I stream it, I'll do it on a slightly lower difficulty. I will have beat it by then, hopefully, though, on Brutal on my own, so we get that going for us. Why are you not dying? There. But yeah, we are on the home stretch. The other thing that's interesting that I'd never realized before, or at least not unless I play them back to back, is how much longer the second game is compared to this one. I think this was chapter 19, and we're maybe 3 chapters from the end, whereas in the second game I'm on chapter 23, and like I said, probably about 3/4 of the way through. So there's definitely more to get through, which is why it's another reason that for streaming purposes we'll do it on slightly easier mode. It's hilarious that I call it slightly easier because I struggled so much with certain fights on Crushing. But now that I've had to do them on brutal, it's like, oh, baby mode. Oh, Dookie. What? Where'd you go? Go fight the other guys, you damn Nazis. Ow! You fuckers. Yeah, in terms of what I did for horses this weekend, I rode Zara Friday and Saturday. Saturday I was really easy with her because she was pretty sore. And she actually just had her hooves done this week. And we think part of the problem that she got all her soreness before was because of her hooves being done. Some horses get really, really sensitive after their hooves are trimmed. It's not abnormal, it's not bad or anything, it's just you have to know that about your horse, and then if that's the case, they just need to be, you know, treated a little bit more gingerly after they get their trimming done, so you don't make them sore. So that was definitely the case for her. So yeah, I was very gentle with her on Saturday. Barely even rode her at all. Didn't I ride her bareback, actually? I think I did. Which is funny, because I haven't ridden her bareback before.
You put the pad on, remember? Because I was making fun of her.
Right, I put the pad on Saturday. I rode her bareback for a little bit on Friday. That's what it was. She actually had two easy days. But yeah, we have a bareback pad that that Zare uses on his horse sometimes. A bareback pad is essentially kind of like a cross between a saddle pad and a saddle, except it doesn't have any of the parts of a saddle except for the girth. But it's like a curved pad, very small profile, sits right at the top of their back, and then you have a single girth strap that goes around it. There's no stirrups or anything like that. It's meant to be a very lightweight piece of equipment that you use when you're riding your horse without a saddle. The idea is that it gives you a little bit more purchase than just their bareback does. And if you are having trouble with balance, it can actually help you balance. I think it's almost psychological, but I'm sure there's some physical reason for it too. Like, I feel more stable when I'm sitting on one, even though I know it's not like my feet are in anything, it's not like I have anything to hold on to, but in my mind it feels more stable.
Well, think about it. The pad is a certain level of firmness versus the hard back of the horse.
Mm-hmm.
And your horse is a sausage.
She is a sausage. Not in a bad way either. She's just very, she's a muscle sausage, yes. That's her official breed designation, muscle sausage.
So, the pad you're sinking into a bit, which means your body's balancing better and the pad absorbs more shocks, whereas her bare back doesn't absorb that level of shock. Also, there's like,
this fucker just waiting for me.
Stuff, right?
Yeah, that's the, especially in the summer, bareback pads are nice because your horse gets sweaty very quick. And sweat, as you can imagine, is pretty slippery.
Well, a certain level of sweat is good and then it's bad. It's like oil.
Gotcha. Because oil is lubricant after so much, but it's sticky before it's slippery. Oh, hey. Hey, fuck off. This is what I mean about letting them fight each other. The soldiers will take care of a good chunk of the, oh fuck, of the monster people for you. I keep forgetting they're called, what is it, Ascendant, you said?
Descendants,
yeah.
Descent, not ascent.
Yeah, they came after heaven. Fuck, this gnat has been in here for like 3 days. I find it to be the most annoying thing in the world, and I'm dead. Fuck. Oh, you did have a dream about me. Remember?
No.
So, This is good. So Zare was telling me he had a dream about me beating the super secret final boss of Bayonetta 2.
Oh, right. I forgot. It's impossible.
Right, because he thinks I won't be able to do it.
He won't be able to do it.
But what he forgot to mention is that after I beat the boss, for some reason, the PS4 turned off. It is my mission to make sure that I can remember that forever, because I never get to not be the fucker up. I am always the fucker up. Oh, God. That was a good time.
Terrible.
It was a terrible time. But at least I didn't lose the checkpoint. Oh, wait, yes, I did. Yeah, sort of lost the checkpoint.
Referencing the fact that I unplugged.
Oh, they know. They know about it, don't worry. Oh.
No, unplug it now.
Don't do it now. Come on, you fucko. Yeah, eat him, Nazi, eat him. Ow, fucker.
Okay.
But yeah, I always like having dreams had about me. Why, also, when I shoot off these fuckers' helmets, why can't I take the helmet?
I don't know, maybe because you shot it off.
I'd probably just put a dent in it. God, stop showing up when I don't have a good gun for you. At times, it does seem like they're infinite, but they aren't. There's just that many that run around. Alright, there we go. Now I have more bullets. I think I can start advancing, but usually when you hear them shooting, that means there's still monster guys running around. I know they're supposed to be the Spaniards, but I'm just going to keep calling them Nazis forever, because to me, zombie Nazis is way more threatening than zombie Spaniards. No offense, Spaniards. Yeah, I see you over there, you ding-dong. Damn, that was a nice shot. Thank you, me. You're welcome. Fuck! Fuck! Nope, that's not where I want to be! Okay, that's better. Drake, where are you aiming that? You're behind me. I got this. I'm almost through the damn area. It's not a guy, is it? I'm shooting at nothing. Okay, cool. Oh, fuck. I forgot about the sniper.
Damn it.
Oh, God. Run away. Run away. No. Okay, get on the box. That's fine. Nazis can't climb boxes. I have no bullets, but it's fine. He's just waiting for me down there. I need this, and then I need this. Can I kill you with 5 bullets? 1, 2. Oh, 2 is enough. Alright. Let's take care of this guy before he kills me. I'm gonna be an asshole. They're assholes to me. I'm gonna be assholes to them. Good night. Alright. Woo! Final stretch here. A few more Nazis pop out if I recall correctly. But fuck them. Don't gotta kill them. Keep on running. And luckily they forgot how to climb ladders too. Alright. One more super long douchey fight. And we're at the bend, boys and girls.
Sully, are you there? Damn it! Sully, come in!
Oh, thank God, mate. Where are you?
Heading your way. They've got Elena. We have to stop them.
Yeah, got problems of my own. Bastards have me pinned down outside the church.
Almost there.
This will be an interesting fight. Might not be doing this part on brutal. Trying to think of what else I did with horses. Like I said, Zara had an easy ride. Today I rode Lacey. I gave Zara completely the complete day off because of how stiff she was. Lacey was doing great. She's been working a little bit, not a whole lot, but their summer camp that they do every year, this year had a pretty damn good turnout. I'm thinking because everyone's tired of being stuck at home. So yeah, they have been quite busy with summer camp, and because of that, they're low on horses, which is hilarious for a barn that has 60 some horses. Play a good game for once. Oh, ho, ho, ho. I could tell them the same thing, but I'm a nice person. yeah, no, he's not in luck because the next three games are all Uncharted. However, I did promise him that I would put in Alien Isolation, which I might do before the Tomb Raider games. Because apparently that would be hilarious to watch me scream through that game again. I have beat it before, but yeah, that was on the normal difficulty, and I definitely still screamed the entire time. That's a very, very scary and difficult game. Yeah, that's the worst thing about it. It's not just scary, it's just a damn hard game. So, yeah. I definitely actually would enjoy playing it again, though. Because the experience was that good and rewarding. But, like I said, when I beat that game, I felt incredible. Like, there's some games that when you beat, you're like, okay, I'm done with it. That game, when I beat it, it was just a case of, holy shit, I can't believe I did it. And I remember getting to the end of the game and thinking, wait, this is the end? We pushed through it, like, in 2 hours straight. I just went through the entire last few levels all at once. So that was kind of exciting. Fuck. But yeah, so I know he can't come on Sundays because of work and all that good stuff. But I don't know, maybe we'll change our streaming night up for that game or something, because I know DMC would enjoy hearing me scream and cry and scream and cry. There would be a lot of both. Alright, so this fight does have a recommended strategy. And if I can pull it off, it's definitely a little bit better. But, yeah, it's a hard fight no matter what you do. Obviously, I did beat it before, but it was not easy. And that's why I'm pretty sure I'm not going to be doing it on Brutal tonight. Oh, right, we have the cathedral for this, too. Yeah. All right, one more, and then I'm going to drop it down. Which game? Alien Isolation. Is the one I'm gonna sneak in somewhere at some point. Like I said, I think after I finish the Uncharted games, I might redo that one. It's been long enough that I would not remember most of it. Alright, maybe it said to hide here for this part and then go to Sully. Because this way the snipers can't see you. Oh, fuck, he's not dead.
Okay.
Alright, oh. Hey, we reached the next stage. I think this is a checkpoint. Which we'll find out for sure in a minute. Yep, that was a checkpoint. Okay. Whew. Alright, let's go ahead and drop it down. Otherwise, we'll be here all night. They spawn slower too? Seems like it anyway. Alright. So yeah, this last, I mean, it makes sense. Like I said, this is the end game. So these four or five fights in a row were all just ridiculous. All the worst enemy types, all coming at you at all angles. Very little cover. There is a nice way to cheese the fight that comes after this one, which is definitely how I did it on Brutal. I don't even remember if I did it on purpose. I think I cheesed it because I was getting so frustrated. I started just trying every technique I could. Which, to be fair, every single video guide that you find for Brutal says if you're having trouble, just start doing anything. Like, try anything and everything. They don't know what they're dealing with. Because eventually you'll find a technique that does work. And persistence is what will let you win. Come again. There's no time. We've got to get to the church. Sorry if you guys missed that. Basically what Nate said is that the statue makes you into a cursed monkey man. And we have to stop them from stealing it. Which that should be obvious by now, considering all the converted Nazis that we've been fighting. Yeah, they sure are, buddy. So yeah, the technique that I used for this fight was run down the stairs like a little bitch and snipe them as they come out to fight you. It worked! It actually worked really well. Because they have a harder time pinning you down if you're out here. When you're in there, you have the pillar as cover, but it's super easy for them to swarm you from both sides, especially since you can't see both sides when you're trying to pick people off. When you're here, there's only one way they can get you, which is right down the middle. I know I'm on hard difficulty, so I probably don't even need to do this, but I'm going to do it anyway. Because I think even on hard, it's going to be easier. And the thing is, even on hard, I can still die pretty quickly if 10 people are shooting me at once. Again, though, your NPC is your friend. Sully is absolutely part of the reason this works, because a lot of them don't even come down the stairs to get me. They're actually coming to try to get Sully. But remember, he's invincible. You don't have to worry about protecting him. He can have 10 guys on him, and he'll be just fine. That probably deserves a Hiko Bert. However, the sniper guys will still kill you in one hit. They'll get the laser dots, so I'll still have to look out for them. See, they're actually more dangerous on hard mode than they are in brutal and crushing, because they take so long to hit you. Whereas every other enemy just points at you with their finger guns and you die. Oh hey, you fellas. You may or may not remember this, but this is the church that we were in earlier in the game when we did all that parkouring across the top. And now you know why there was all this parkouring, because now there's guys on it. So the reason for it to exist is for assholes to be on top of it later, I guess. Alright, Sully, we get everyone? No, there's still one more. Oh, roll.
Ah, crap.
I forget if there's another way from the front or from the back. We're gonna find out in a second. Nope, from the front. I do at least get to use my favorite technique. Oh god, there's still someone here. Which is running up to them and shooting them in the eye. As you can see though, this is all one long checkpoint. Part of the reason why this is such a miserable fight.
Thank you.
Oh god, there's still someone back here? Oh, no, no, that's the guys at the back. That's the guys at the back. Alright, we're at the last stage. Oh, alright. Phew! This, luckily, is a checkpoint. I see you up there, I know, you're very annoying. Okay. Come on. Yep. Yep. Yep.
Come on, Sully.
Alright.
There should be a hidden passage right under the altar.
I know everyone's thinking, hey, why isn't he getting more ammo? Don't worry. I know what I'm doing. I guess I should turn it back up to brutal and see if I can do this last part. How many tries did it take me? Doing this next part on brutal? The very end? Well, the second to very end? Like, only three, right? Because I actually did it the right way. Alright, we still have a few more caverns to go through.
Drake didn't want to get the treasure off.
Alright, so I should have grabbed some ammo.
He was trying to stop it from leaving.
What?
It's cursed or something.
Oh, Nate, for God's sake.
Look, I know it sounds crazy. You just gotta trust me.
Yeah, you haven't seen the Nazi monkey monsters, sir. Alright. Fight a few of those guys and then you'll see why I think the treasure's cursed. Are there no enemies? Maybe not. Nope, just the very end. Okay. Well, like I said, almost very end.
Oh, man. Whoa.
You two should realize by now that I plan for every contingency. Drop your weapons. Down there. No heroics, please. Or I will kill her.
Sully has a really nice revolver, so making him throw it down in that pit of goop is really mean.
Now, if you'll just hang tight, we'll be with you in a moment. It's magnificent. Craftsmanship. I've never seen anything like it before.
That is only a shell. The real treasure of El Dorado lies inside. Open it! My God.
I implicitly trust my henchmen.
We don't even get the satisfaction of killing this douche.
Navarro, that thing wiped out an entire colony. You don't know what you're doing.
Wrong. I'm the only person on this island who knows what the hell he's doing.
Exactly. That was my first thought. No one in this game has seen Raiders of the Lost Ark.
You are so
Navarro did, obviously.
Any idea what this is worth to the right buyer?
I don't know, like $100? By the way, that means lift it. For those who were wondering what the Spanish was.
What the hell is that?
Yeah, you know, you're the one who had to go firing your gun and you summon some more Nazis. Spaniards, Nazis. Both. Bye, fuckos.
My god. If that thing gets off the island,
you gotta stop him. I'll cover you from here.
Alright. So what worked for me last time is doing what you're supposed to do. Oh, I'm gonna do this first though, because I promised I would. Go in the water. Instant death. The Nazis thought of that. The stream needed to see it. It's a very important secret death cutscene, okay? Anyways, what you're supposed to do is just run. Pull the trigger and keep running. That's it. Don't sit there and try and shoot them all. Don't worry about it. Just run. When these guys show up, shoot them. Just shoot them. Don't stop to aim. Just shoot them. When I did this on crushing, I had to do this, what, 20 times? At least. I did it in one go. One go on brutal mode.
You tried to sneak your way up.
Yeah, I tried to sneak my way up because I was like, every time someone shoots me, it's going to die because they have a shotgun and it's all one-hit kills. Hey, amigo. So yeah, doing that on brutal when I realized the trick is just to do what you're supposed to do, shock, you get through it pretty quick. Hey there, I'm Drake. I love you, Elena. Oh, Elena. I don't love you as much now, though. But I still love you. Fucko. That means kill him. Oh, DMC's so funny with his jokes. Is he not at work today? Does he have the day off? I thought he was like never had days off anymore. On Sundays anyway. I'm not offended if he doesn't want to watch, don't worry. Anyways, I really want to get to the one super death scene, which is a checkpoint, so I guess I could actually just lower it and get there first, but I'll see what I can do before that. So you start this fight only with the shotgun. Oh, he took the whole week off for his birthday. Okay, nice. So yeah, you start this entire series of fights with a shotgun, which normally is not a bad thing. But in this case, it kind of sucks because they will all run to the other side and you just have to hope you can kill them before they can shoot you, you know, once, because they're using long range guns. So they all kill you immediately. Yeah. Let's see if I can get to the checkpoint without... Oh, you bastard. I wasn't ready for you. Fuck. yeah, so you can't run, you can't shoot, you can't punch them, you can't do anything except for try not to immediately die when they run at you with their bigger guns. Technically their guns aren't bigger, but they do more damage at range. But when they do that, that's nice. Eat a chode. Alright, once he runs away, you're good. Did I back the Kickstarter? No, I didn't yet, but I do have it bookmarked, so as soon as this is done, I'm 100% going to. It looks like it just started, too. Okay. A brand new, fresh Kickstarter. This week is pretty stressful because it also includes two other birthdays. Oh, gotcha. Okay, that makes sense. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. I don't do it myself, but I absolutely understand why people choose to take time off for their birthday. I mean... Why not? Most people don't end up using all their holiday anyway. Well, I should... Let me reword that. The less money you have, the less likely you are to use all your holidays. I've learned that. Because I almost never use all of my holidays. I almost always have some left at the end of every year. And it doesn't roll over, so it's like... nice. Yes, so LV sent me that OC Kickstarter... that they said you showed, and I was immediately interested because I started laughing my ass off at the idea of having a custom Hiko dick for once, since it's one of those things that you'll never find on Bad Dragon for sure. So yeah, I have not backed it yet, but I did see it, and I have it bookmarked, because that tickles me pink, and I think that is a worthy venture.
You're the worst person.
You haven't even seen it yet, so you
don't need to see it to know.
Everyone wants a Hiko dick, all right? Everyone wants a Hiko dick. Alright, so this part is not the douchey part, it's the one right after this. I actually got through these first two fights without too much problem. The number of times you saw me die that first time is pretty much the number of times I died doing it originally. Like I said, it's not hard, this first part, it's the part that comes after this that it gets really, 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 really douchey. Because it's a death that you can't stop. Oh yeah, no, that tickles me, like I said, and I'm gonna actually read it in more detail when I get a sec. There we go. All right, let's see if I can find any more ammo. Also, my little trick for getting more ammo in this game. It works even better in the second game on Brutal Mode. So in this game, you switch weapons to get more ammo. In the second game, what you do is actually... You drop the gun, pick up another gun, and then pick up the first gun. And then you get the amount of ammo that was in it before, along with the new ammo. In this game, it doesn't let you do that. But in the second game, yeah, if you were very careful about picking up guns in alternating order... you can quickly max out the clip, which is really nice. Because like I said, there's a lot more very long, very painful fights in the second game. So ammo consumption is even more stressful. Alright, there's one more guy over there. You might notice Navarro is the one with the laser sight. He's the one just sitting there shooting happily. You can't do anything about him right now. Oh god! Well, okay. Alright, I'm going to lower it to the checkpoint because this is an annoying stretch. Can't actually change the difficulty until I get to the checkpoint, but I will show you guys the fun here. Okay, so you see that quick time? All right, now let's see if I can do it within 10. We're at 283. Yeah, that's one. Absolutely unforgiving. Because you can't dodge early. You can't get to cover. And the little flinch that Drake does is unavoidable. Except unless sometimes you can avoid it by mashing the aim button and getting to cover. Which I actually did that time. But then I rolled again because I'm an idiot. So yeah, I would estimate I died here 40 times, maybe? Maybe 50? Before I got through it. Because then, of course, after you survive this, you then have to kill everyone to advance to the next stage. Yeah. This is Brutal Mode, everyone. Good job, game designers. You knew what you were doing. What did I start at? 283? Still have a chance here. Get to cover. Alright, there we go. And then, of course, yeah, you still have to survive the fight itself. One more chance. Or I guess two more chances. Oh man. But I did it. I did it, and that's all that matters. Okay. Yeah, this is one of those parts that I would have enjoyed watching the playtesters go through and what part of it made them think, yeah, this is fair. We should keep this in.
Got you.
There we go.
Okay. Nowhere to hide now. Elena.
Of course we lose our gun. Why wouldn't we lose our gun?
Crap, now what?
All right, okay. I couldn't remember if you had to go before or after. I guess I could beat it on. No matter what, you're gonna die in one hit, so might as well do it on Brutal. That way I can say I finished the game on Brutal. I forget, I thought you just run at him. Two shots. Move cover. One, two, move cover. One, two. Punch him! He also knows how to do hand-to-hand combat. That's how Drake finishes an enemy. Right in the nuts.
Elena. Elena. Oh god. Elena.
Well shit. Could just start the second one. 7:30.
Okay. You alright?
Oh, Nate.
Oh wait, sorry. We might still die, guys. Hold on. Why you always check your surroundings, amigo. He got meted. Exactly. Ugh.
Quite a day.
Yeah, save the world, triumph over evil. Pretty typical.
Really?
That's a shame we're leaving empty-handed, though.
Oh, well, you know, I did manage to save one small thing. Here, I thought you might miss this.
Oh. Keeper material.
Thanks. Yeah.
You two got a funny idea of romantic.
Sully! Wow, you look like hell.
You should see the other guy. Got us a boat.
We already have a boat.
Yeah, big boat.
Big boat.
I like this one better.
Sully, you beautiful son of a bitch.
Borrowed it off a couple of pirates who were too dead to care.
Sorry you didn't get your story.
No, that's all right. There'll be other stories. You still owe me one.
I'm good for it.
Guys, we did it under 300 kills, or deaths rather. I'm aware that I cheated, but still. Under 300 kills, deaths, kills, Drake kills. I can't even say it because I know I cheated, but we all know I cheated, so it's fine. And I can show the achievement that says I did it for those who don't believe me anyway. But I know you guys all believe me. You know I wouldn't lie. Mascot, morale builder, and food patrol. I'm guessing Pogo is a dog. Lone wolf! Back when Naughty Dog made good games. Wah, wah, wah. Good old Nolan North. Also good old Richard McGonagall. That was Robin Atkin Downs. He's so good at doing generic foreign voices. I like how also, yeah, that's right, the Descendants right there. Steve Blum and Fred Tatasciore were both the Nazi voices, which is hilarious to me. That of all the talents to get for, you get two of the best in the business. And they just do animal sounds. So that's Uncharted 1. Yeah, we can actually jump right into the second one because we get an hour and a half, so I beat that faster than I thought I would. It is still funny to me just how much faster the first game is than the second, but the more I think about it, the more it makes sense. The first game, like I said, was a release title. It was one of the ones that came out with the first line of the PS3, so it was included with a lot of them. As a matter of fact, it wasn't even a separate purchase. And even though it was Naughty Dog, I'm sure, you know, they weren't sure where it was going to go. So yeah, it's not a super long game. The second one kicks up everything. So everything that I liked about the first game, when I started playing the second game, I was just like, wow, all the things that I love were taken and doubled or tripled. The banter between the characters, the detail of things going on, the story, the length, the gameplay itself, they all got improved on, so I'm excited. And I'm excited to share it with y'all. Even if Dookie is ruining things. Let's see, while the credits play, I'm trying to think if there's anything else that I got distracted from talking about at the beginning. So the latest trend at the barn is trying to get your horse to lie down, because Zara and I were both working on it with our horses. And his horse Quattro loves to roll, but so far he hasn't been able to put a command to it. When it comes to my horse, Zara, she rolls, but she hasn't done it in a while. I'm thinking it's partially because of her soreness and her stiffness. And usually I can't get her to roll unless I'm completely ignoring her, which makes it hard to treat her or put a command to it. Because if I'm halfway across the arena and not looking at her when she starts to roll, it's hard to time it properly. So there's a few other techniques to get your horse to do it. You can also, you can lift up one of their front legs and kind of guide them down essentially by taking away one of their standing points and kind of pulling it against them. And they'll just sort of naturally lie down if you do it right. I haven't been able to get that to work either, but she's also very strong and very stubborn, which is probably part of it. So the last technique you can do is when they lie down, you essentially just jump on their neck and feed them treats, so they think it's a good thing. I haven't been able to do either, and the few times that I've been close enough where she did roll, I was too scared to jump on her neck for fear of hurting her, even though I'm sure she'd be fine, because like I said, she's all muscle, even with as big as I am. So anyways, one of the ladies who owns the barn, apparently she got her horse to learn it in one day, and her technique was similar, where he rolled over and laid down, and so she just immediately hopped on his neck. And he couldn't get up, so she just started shoving treats in his mouth. And apparently within a few, what, was it the first time that she did it when it happened? And he just started pawing at the ground, or was that later? Okay.
God, I mean, he got it right away.
He definitely understood right away that it was a good thing. And it got to the point on that same day when he would lie down, he would start pawing at the ground while still on his side for her to treat him and shove treats in his face. So she got lucky and taught him very quickly. I haven't thought about teaching it to Lacey, but I did happen to be next to her when she was out in the field rolling after we rode today. And I was a little afraid of jumping on her neck again, like I said. So what I did instead is I just hopped on her back while she was on her side. And she just kind of stood up calmly with me on her back and then just stood there. So that was actually a really, really cool little experience that it made me a lot less nervous about trying it. Because if it's a horse that you trust and if it's a horse that trusts you, chances are they aren't immediately going to start running off and bucking when you jump on their back, even if you did it while they're lying down. But the yeah, so what you do with the horse is you take one of their two front legs, you pull it back against their chest, and then you don't really twist their body, but you kind of just put pressure into their shoulder so that their weight shifts to the other leg. And since it's the only front leg standing, the idea is that they will just kind of naturally roll down into it. And horses are very capable of rolling over nice and slow, so it's absolutely doable. But like I said, Zara is both stubborn and strong. So yeah, she did basically what you're describing. She just locked her legs and said, nope, whatever you're trying to do, I don't think so. So yeah,